It's Jimmy Fake Laugh Fallon versus Matthew He Killed People. Look it up, Broderick. In the Battle of the Blands. Whose cringe is cringier? Only we can bring you the answer on Deep Fat Fried. Everybody, welcome to yet another goddamn stinking motherfucking edition of everybody's favorite show, Deep Fat Fried. Welcome one, welcome all.
I hate you for this episode, TJ. I just want to let you know.
Oh, you fucking, on several occasions have you defended Matthew Broderick.
That's why I hate you for this episode, because you put a good man up next to Jimmy Fallon in comparison, as if there's any comparison. Like, that's like comparing a flower to, like, a big puddle of whale semen or some shit. You know what I mean? It's like, you can't do that, dude. Matthew Broderick is a national treasure, TJ.
Well, let's see if you're right.
And Jimmy fucking Fallon is a national venereal disease, okay?
So, I will tell you...
Paul can't even be objective here, TJ. So the biased nature of this episode has to be called into question. Paul's
let me tell you something.
Dude, I was not consulted about this episode, Scotty. You know what I mean? I can only do what I can do.
I understand that, Paul, but I mean, you know what? Oh, it seems like your vote is already bought and paid for, is what I'm saying.
I'm gonna fucking let you know right now too. Mm-hmm. I'm coming in this episode feeling like Matthew Broderick is about 10,000 times worse than Jimmy Fallon.
Oh my God, you're fucking. No, you're ridiculous.
I'm completely biased too. So you know what? Because I hate Matthew Broderick with a glowing red hot passion. So you know what? I'm biased as well. But you know what?
I hate him.
I'm willing. I'm willing to set my bias aside and be objective. So that's what I'm gonna do here today.
Well, good luck.
I mean, but Paul's his vote has already been bought and paid for.
Roger, I will tell you this. Usually,
Chris, $100 bills.
Think about this, dude. Put yourself in my shoes, okay. Scotty. You got to have a little empathy. What if he was like David Bowie versus, you know, John Cougar Mellencamp? Who's the lamest of the lame?
I'd have to be objective, man.
Exactly. You'd be in the same boat.
Well, let me tell you this.
The boat of objectivity, Paul.
Let me tell you this. So in the past, there's been a chance for these episodes. Like, there's never been a chance for a tie. But in this particular edition, I left room for a tie. So we could have ourselves the very first one of these episodes. It's tied up at the end.
Gross.
It's like, they're both equally lame.
Gross. I think we have tied at one point. I think one of them, but we did like a runoff or some shit. We had to.
Pretty sure we've always had enough categories to not have a tie, but right. I don't know. I could be wrong on that.
You could be. You probably are.
I think we're the first ever deep fat.
I have a terrible memory, so you know. No, but I believe it's the first time.
You probably are wrong.
Yeah.
You probably got it completely fucking wrong, TJ.
Just assume TJ's wrong, but in our minds, it's the first time it could ever happen.
So our categories are early life, TV, film, other cringe, crowning achievements, and then a special bonus round.
Yeah. All right. Well, fuck. I'm telling you, man. You're going to have to climb a mountain to convince me that fucking Matthew Broderick is anywhere near as cringy as Jimmy Fallon, bro. Mount Everest to climb, because there's just no way.
The facts is the facts. I don't know what to tell you. So let's start with early life, shall we? Early life. Okay. Which one is this? Can you tell at a glance?
That's Matthew Broderick.
Enhance. That is
Matthew Jimmy Fallon, if I've ever seen him. It's Jimmy Fallon. Right.
Matthew Broderick was born in Manhattan, New York on March 21st, 1962. He is the son of an actress, playwright, and painter, Patricia Biao Broderick, and James Broderick, a World War II veteran and actor. All right.
Okie dokie.
So, oh, damn it.
He comes from a long line of thespians, TJ. Is that what you're trying to say?
Yeah. That's what I'm trying to say.
Long and prestigious line.
Did you just say lesbians?
Yes, I did.
Cool. I think we could, like, score with them or something.
So here's the lesbian mom.
Whoa. Look at her. Wow. I'm, like, stunned or something. This bitch is hot.
Yep.
Oh, my God. I'm got a boner now. Is this Matthew Broderick's mom?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
This is his mom, Dykes. Yes, Dykes is his mom, yeah.
Oh, my God.
Why the fuck?
What's wrong with you, TJ? What's happening?
I don't know. I'm pissed off because my fucking, the keyboard shortcut. Okay, now it's working. All right, I don't know.
What are you doing, TJ? Who's this guy? We don't even know what's going on here, man.
This is his dad right here. This is fucking dad.
This episode is going to hell in a handbasket, TJ. What are you doing?
My fucking keyboard shortcut stopped working for a second.
Oh, my keyboard's broken. I want to hear your fucking excuses, TJ. Neither are people in this audience.
Shut the fuck up. This is Matthew Broderick's dad.
You don't
have
fucking
an
tell me to shut up, TJ.
Have an opinion about this guy. Tell me about this dude.
Looks
he
like
looks
a
like
well
an actor.
Gentleman.
He looks like, was he in, fuck, what's the name of that movie? God damn it.
I don't know.
He looks
Paul.
Like some dude that would be in like the Twilight Zone. You know,
it's
some
a fucking,
like, yeah.
It's a really early, Kubrick movie, I want to say. The Heist or some shit.
Let's see.
The Heist.
James Broderick, IMDb. I'll see if he's actually been in, if he has any actual credits. It's James Broderick.
Oh, fuck.
Anything going on there?
Seeing he was in.
He looks familiar to me.
I got to make sure this is even the right dude. Is
James
the
Joseph Broderick the Third.
Yeah.
Right? That's who you're looking at? Yeah.
I think that's him. So, yeah, he's, I don't know, he's in fucking a few movies. Afternoon.
Yeah. So, I have seen him in shit then.
Yeah.
He looks really familiar. I'm trying to see. What else was he in?
And by the way, he actually was on The Twilight Zone at one point. He was on.
Yeah.
On Thursday, Dude. We leave for home.
Okay, cool. Yeah. I'm like, you kind of reminded me of like someone I had seen on the show. So
it was on it was in the weird season where Twilight Zone episodes were like an hour long instead of being like 20 minutes or whatever.
Yeah. Whatever. They were like 25 minutes or some shit.
So that's like the one season I'd haven't really seen much of. But
that's really cool.
The premise of his episode is the first human space colony is about to be rescued from the forsaken planet they've been to for 3 decades. But their leader's having a hard time accepting the change will happen when they get back.
See, dude, they're already a cool point for Matthew Broderick, dude. His dad was on The Twilight Zone.
Help, I'm slipping into the Twilight Zone.
The original, though, before it's, you know what I mean? Like the OG Rod Serling Twilight Zone, not the new fucking cringe-inducing Twilight Zone, dude.
Oh, the Jordan Peele?
Yeah.
Yeah, that's some weird shit. His mother's of a Jewish descent, Jewish immigrant from Germany.
Never mind, take it back. He was a piece of shit.
What are you saying, TJ?
I've changed. I've suddenly changed my opinion on this guy for some reason. I don't know what it is. I can't. Really? I can't put my finger on the nose of it. I mean, I can't. You know what I mean?
His father was Irish Catholic. So.
Oh my God! I hate him. I hate him even more now. Holy shit! A fucking pope worshiper. Oh my God. A papist and a Jew? Wait a minute. A papist and a Jew? The son of a papist and a Jew? Flush this man down the toilet. Get his disgusting mongrel ass from this land. His kind were never welcomed here. Sorry. What Broderick just happened? Did I just have like a racist outburst for no reason? Why did I do that?
Yeah, pretty much.
Did I challenge an old? Did I challenge like an old relative of mine that used to live back in the days where that shit was a thing? Like being a papist was a bad idea.
You mean channel?
Channel, yeah, yeah, channel. Did I channel it?
I like the channel things.
Did I channel it?
Channel.
Do you take a channel?
Challenge the first time. Did I challenge an old relative? I'm like, what the fuck is he talking about?
Did I say challenge?
I feel like you did.
I don't know what you heard. Said.
Whatever. I just came out of a trance where I channeled an ancient dead relative. Okay, give me a second to get back together. I said horrible things, though. I remember saying all of them and wondering why they were coming out of my mouth. It was horrible.
Apparently, my great-great-grandpa used to say, poop on the Pope, which I guess was pretty hardcore for the day.
Oh, yeah,
but anyway.
Yeah, poop on the Pope. That.
Ah, poop on, and people were like, oh, scandal. Broderick received a fine education. He attended grade school at City and Country School in Manhattan and high school at the private Walden School, also in Manhattan.
Of course.
The Walden, yes. Everyone knows.
I attended Walden Academy in Manhattan.
Isn't that the academy?
Very relatable.
Isn't that the academy that, what's his name? You've seen Dutch, right?
Yeah, Dutch is good.
Isn't that the academy that the little snooty kid goes to?
I don't think so, but maybe.
The Let's Walden see. School.
God damn it, Paul. Making me fact check this shit.
I'm just
Dutch,
checking.
1991. Yeah, hold on. I'm figuring this out. I want to know this now. Because that Dutch is an underrated fucking movie.
Oh,
man.
My God. So underrated, dude. So underrated.
Fucking goddamn classic.
Ed O'Neill maybe gives the finest performance of his career. And he played Al Bundy. So, I mean.
Yeah. It just says prep school. I'm not going to fucking bother.
All right. Fair enough. Never mind.
But here's Matthew Broderick in his first role as a gay dude. His first role acting HB Studio.
He doesn't look like he's he doesn't look very gay.
No.
Even hugging this dude.
Like the way he's holding his hand is very unnatural. While the gay guy, it's very natural the way his fingers are splayed out and the way he's kind of leaning into Matthew. Matthew was not. It feels like he wasn't comfortable with this.
Says that he was hired. It was playing Harvey Fierstein's gay adopted son in Torch Song Trilogy. I don't know what that is. A good review of his gay performance by the New York Times theater critic Mel Gusso allowed Matthew to branch out and become a film actor. Before I knew it, I was like this guy in a hot play, and suddenly all these doors opened, and it's only because Mel Gusso happened to come by right before it closed and happened to like it. It's just amazing. All these things have to line up that are out of your control. That's a Matthew Broderick quote.
Yeah, so it sounds like his life, you know, adversity was definitely an issue for him.
Yep. It's a hard life. It's a hard knock life for us. You know, he had a hard life.
Yeah, man, you know, just you gotta work hard, have rich
parents.
You gotta
work hard, have a rich kid with fucking famous actor parents and shit, you know? And then you just makes it, man.
He had to attend that disgusting, rat-infested cockroach haven known as the Walden School in Massachusetts, which I'm sure is a fucking hole-in-the-wall piece of shit fucking flea-bag scam university. Probably run by your dad at one point, but he took a look at it and he was like, even I won't go near that one.
Even he's like, this is too much a scam.
The scam just comes reeking off of this motherfucker. I'm walking away from this deal.
All right, how about Jimmy? How about little Jimmy?
He was born from the ass of a giant donkey with two pussies named Old Bessie.
Old Bessie.
He was born from the second vagina of Old Bessie the donkey. I know that much, but then I lose track of him for a while until he shows up on Saturday Night Live, pretty much.
Mythological birth, like the two pussy she-wolf or whatever. the two pussy cow.
He's hideous. Look at him here. Doesn't he look like the kid in school that you wanted to punch the most already? Yeah. See, that wasn't true of Matthew Broderick. Matthew Broderick kind of was goofy looking as a kid.
You know what's weird? kid behind him looks like not only virtually identical, but equally punchable.
Well, so that's the thing is like all the guys that look like this all hang in the same crew. So it makes sense that they would all be together in this very casual picture here.
We're the punchable bitch douchebag crew.
I'll be honest, though. I think Jimmy Fallon was the bitch in that group.
Maybe.
He's like the lowest. Oh, he's shorter, man. You can tell.
It depends on how much pussy he was pulling. Because, like, he's like, it depends, really.
I guess that's true.
If the ladies loved him, he was top dog. He was alpha dog, dude. That's just the truth.
He's a master of the fake laugh, so.
Exactly. You know. The key to a woman's heart is making her laugh genuinely. That's absolutely the truth.
Making her feel like she's funny by laughing at the insipid shit she might say.
Hopefully not at the size of your penis.
Yeah.
You know, but anything else?
Here we go. So, Jimmy Fallon was born in Brooklyn, New York. So, another New Yorker. September 19th, 1974, to Gloria and James W. Fallon. His father spent his adolescence singing in street corner doo-wop groups before serving in Vietnam War. This isn't even a real fucking bio. This is made up. It just reads fake.
After his son was born, he was a doo-wop singer before he went to Vietnam.
And then he goes to Vietnam and fucking saw some shit. And he comes back and he starts working as a machine repairman for IBM at that point. Because, you know, doo-wop singer. Vietnam vet, machine repairman for IBM. That's the career trajectory there.
Whatever.
So Fallon described his childhood as idyllic. His parents were overprotective and highly religious. He was not allowed to leave his home unless for church. He and his sister also could only ride their bikes in the backyard.
Another fucking godforsaken papist shows up on my shores. Another papist wearing his dress, what he wears to worship his pope with the pointy hat over in Rome. More and more, they're pouring off the boats every day. Dude, I see them.
Yeah, what's up?
He must have been a Milo, like kind of Catholic, because for an altar boy, he looks real happy. He's like, you know what I mean?
Joke, but all right.
Dark, but true that. He does look extraordinarily happy in this.
Well, I don't know, more dark when the Catholic Church actually did horrible shit like that. So
yeah, exactly. Jimmy originally wanted to be a Catholic priest after his many years as an altar boy and attendance of Roman Catholic school Saint Mary of the Snow.
Dude, if only he had followed that dream, we never would have been exposed to his hideousness. He'd be in some fucking godforsaken chapel somewhere, preaching to a bunch of us, a shrinking congregation of desperate people, but no. Now he just does that, but on TV.
Yeah.
I didn't realize I was describing the actual career that he took. Whoops.
During his teenage years, Jimmy became obsessed with comedy and Saturday Night Live. This is probably in his household some form of rebellion. Although he was allowed to watch and listen to skits deemed appropriate by his parents, and only the ones without foul language. Oh my God,
deemed appropriate? He was one of those kids?
Yep.
This one's
not appropriate for you,
Jimmy.
He ain't
winning this shit. He ain't winning this fucking shit. Dude, there ain't no way he's taking the points in this category, dude. Anybody that votes, dude, right now.
Well, no, Paul, you're supposed to give it to who's cringier, so.
Well, that's what I'm saying. Oh, that's right. They're not trying to win. They're trying to lose.
Yeah, so
he's winning.
So Jimmy might be the runaway winner right now.
Yeah, he's winning for sure. Oh, my God,
Jimmy,
dude.
I don't know if you should. Can you imagine that shit, dude? Like, Jimmy, this skit, this comedy skit is not appropriate. You can't watch it. Come on, Mom.
Mom, there's this really great guy named Sam Kinison, and he's got this comedy special. Can I watch it?
All right, Jimmy, but let your father and I peruse the content first to make sure it's okay.
Oh, gee whiz, Mom. Just one time. Can't you trust me?
Jimmy, it's not that I don't trust you. It's this Samuel Kinison that I don't trust, Jimmy. All right, and Satan, Jimmy, is the one that I don't trust, okay?
All right, Mom.
That dang Satan.
Wow. So here he is. What a dork.
Like,
Oh my God, what a daywalker. What a daywalker. Oh my fucking God, dude. If he walks into the sun, does he burst into fucking flames?
Like I could talk.
Like, dude, this poor bitch. This poor bitch had to go to fucking prom with the Nosferatu, bro. He literally looks like Count Orlok. Like,
what the
fuck? How did he pull a chick like this? Wait a minute. Hold on. Wait a minute. Look, that chick looks like one of his teachers, not a chick that would be in school with him.
Maybe it is.
Did he take one of his teachers to the prom?
I think he did.
Maybe he did, dude. You don't know.
That bitch looks 28.
She does.
All right. No. Jimmy, you're taking the point in this fucking category, Bora.
Hold on. So at Sodrides High School, he was a performer in most stage productions and was twice a class social director. He won a young comedian's contest with an impression of Pee-wee Herman.
Oh my God, what a hack.
Yeah, I know, lame. Right?
That, you know what, dude? You can trace the entire career of Jimmy Fallon back to that moment, too. Somebody rewarded him for some hackneyed, like, shit, and, like, he thinks he's fucking brilliant still.
Well, and now he gets to host The Tonight Show, Paul.
Dude, what's his name? I can't even remember the poor man's name now because I'm so disgusted with Jimmy Fallon's. Can you move to the next picture, please?
No.
It's hurting my eyes. Not
further, TJ. Ears.
Fallon ended up dropping out of college where he was pursuing a computer science and communications degree in order to pursue a career in comedy, so.
Oh, my God, dude. Dude, Johnny Carson is spinning in his fucking grave right now, knowing that this fucking sack of horseshit. Johnny. Oh, my God.
Here's Jimmy.
And you know who Jimmy Fallon was on Saturday Night Live? The guy that fucking picked up Norm McDonald's shtick and tried to run with it like a hack and failed at it.
So he worked doing stand-up improv for many years, making $7.50 per set. About what it is.
He was overpaid.
He was overpaid. He should have been paid in fucking company script that was only, like, fucking redeemable at the bar.
So he tried
to give you a couple Bud Lights.
Yeah, here's what's left of the fucking bottom of the fucking keg for the Bud Lights tonight, Jimmy. Good job up there. Right, it's half a pitcher.
So in 1997, he auditioned for SNL, but got turned down. Then he auditioned again at the age of 23, where he did impressions of Jerry Seinfeld, Chris Rock, Bill Cosby, and Adam Sandler. Fallon's audition was well-received. This time he was accepted and was added to the cast.
Oh, I get it. He basically just blew a bunch of people who were on the show, and then they said, okay, you can be on the cast now.
Yeah. I think they were looking for, like, a new Chris Kattan. They're like, God damn it, we need a new Chris Kattan.
I don't know.
I think you're right.
But all they got was a bootleg fucking Norm McDonald. That's all they really got for their money.
I wouldn't even compare those two.
You have to. They forced the fucking comparison because they made him the Weekend Update guy. That's Norm's job.
Yeah. Why was Norm even ever let go from that? Like, even if you weren't going to use him for anything else, he should have just stayed.
There's an apocryphal story about it. It's one-sided, but it's from Norm. And he claims it was over something that he said to somebody on the cast that they got offended. They went up to fucking, what's his name? Well, who's the guy that runs it?
Lorne Michaels.
Went up to Lorne Michaels and complained, and Lorne came to Norm and wanted to chastise him for what he did and have him apologize, and Norm wouldn't apologize or some shit, and they fired him. And then he went straight and into movies and then got his own show. So it didn't really hurt him much.
Anywho, it's time to vote. And I think
I'm desperate to talk about anybody that isn't fucking Jimmy Fallon. So let's talk about Norm MacDonald from some more. He's awesome.
No.
Shit.
It's time to vote. Everyone.
All right, Jimmy Fallon.
Right? I mean, I want Jimmy Fallon to. I want Broderick to win this, and I still have to vote Fallon because it's just demonstrable.
It's Fallon, dude. Come on.
100%. pure, look, unadulterated
take
cringe.
Every argument you made out and throw it out the window and look at this picture.
Yeah, exactly.
There's my vote.
He's just a dork, man. He's a dork that took his fucking math teacher to fucking prom with him.
You've made dork beyond dork. Then you get Jimmy fucking Fallon, dude.
He took his math teacher to prom, bro. Look at him.
He did.
Look at him.
But did he slay that pussy?
Yeah, did he fuck, though? That's what I guarantee you he didn't. He didn't fucking seal the deal.
No, he was beating
him. I don't know, man. This is one of those guys that, you know, we can sit here and hate on him, but he's had the fucking devil's run of luck, man.
True that. I don't know what to say against that.
All right, so we're doing television work now. Matthew Broderick never really had too much television work. Some of his standout roles include Prince Henry in Shelley Duvall's Fairy Tale Theater, which I guess is what we're going to check out here.
Okay.
I'm just going to take
is
a little
Is this recent
brief.
Or when? Oh, no, I guess from, it looks like 2000.
This is a while back. Right. This is like ancient history of shit.
Sure.
But we'll take a little brief look at what he does here.
Such a lovely dress.
Oh, thank you. Thank you, Prince Henry.
For what?
For kissing my hand. I'll never wash it again. Thank you.
Well, it's horrible, and I would never
All right,
watch
well,
it.
Whatever. Years, this is but... You can tell from the sets and shit that they've taken a theatrical show and they've put cameras in everybody's face.
Yep.
This viewed from an actual audience. See, that's the thing about Matthew Broderick that makes me fucking like him, TJ, is he's got actual theater chops. I saw this dude on Broadway. He played the main character in How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying, which was a brand new show at the time that I went to see it. I don't know. I think it was another running of it, but he played the fucking lead in it, and he carried it great. He's a great singer.
His first, the notoriety that he originally got was from his performance in a stage play. So sure. I mean, that kind of tracks. But plays are not a category here, so. What are you gonna do?
Well, that's all I'm saying is it's not cringe points for me. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
That he's a
we
good.
All know,
that,
we
like,
all know
like,
what
oh, we're cringe. He's good at theater, bro. He's a good actor. Oh, cringe.
I think we're gonna the psychology Paul's in Paul's psychology a little bit. It's like, you know what? He's in theater. He got that. We got
dude,
those
game
chops,
recognized
man.
Game. Not everybody in theater has the talent to be an actor with a fucking actual career. You know what I mean?
No, of course.
Giving you a little signal.
Oh, no, 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 no. Goodbye.
No, 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 no. Goodbye. I don't know, man.
See, you don't know if you don't know if the character calls for this kind of like stuck up type of shit. You're just fucking like you're judging a book by its cover. You're like looking at 2 seconds of an entire work and going like, this sucks. Next.
Okay.
This sucks. Next. Yeah.
You know what? Now this that you mention next. It, I think that was brilliant. I think it was brilliant. I was because I was so moved by his performance. I was like, wow, I really buy him.
No, no,
what
no, no.
He's doing here.
This sucks.
No, 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 no. Bye. That's what that. No, that was a great.
I thought I'll just do it. This sucks next.
The Duke of Blandington. Yes, of course. All right. So this is from 30 Rock.
Okay. Are we gonna? Can we show this on TV, dude?
I'm gonna fucking. We're just gonna have. I can't fucking possibly do this episode without fucking playing these clips. So.
All right.
We're gonna see how it goes.
Roll
here he is.
That beautiful bean footage.
So here he is arguing with Alec Baldwin here.
Where would we get the money? No congressman in his right mind would support this.
Don't worry, I've got a friend in Congress.
But not your best friend, right?
Oh, God, I hate him so much. Not your best friend, right?
I mean, he's pretty bland in that scene.
He's every scene he's ever been in. He's just that bland shit.
He played Ferris Bueller, dipshit. He's anything but bland in that film.
Flat fucking Matthew Broderick, lazy fucking delivery of every line.
He played Ferris Bueller in American...
100 years ago!
An American fucking icon!
You know what? We're not even on movies yet. We're on television right now. So
whatever. I'm just telling you that, like, he's not, like, a dude that you can just go, like, oh, all he ever does is act bland. He played Ferris fucking Bueller at one point in his career.
Reduce enemy soldiers' combat posture... by making them totally gay bones for each other.
How gay?
It doesn't say. The project was abandoned in the planning stages.
Of course. See, this needs a straight man. They need a straight man, and they got it. Dude, he's great at playing the straight man. That's what he is in How to Succeed in Business. He's a straight man amidst all the crazies that he works around. Mm-hmm. It's fucking like he's credited.
Well, here he is playing a gay man instead.
Yeah, I mean, he usually plays a pretty convincing. Yeah, yeah.
So here we go.
Your hand's shaking. Remember, Dave, it's just a game.
Oh, God. Oh, my God. Gosh. Oh, come here.
It's all right. When are they going
to
kiss?
Oh, wait. Dude, he's about to rub him down, dude.
Hold on. They're taking off their shirts now.
Interception. Oh. Interception. Oh, come on, buddy. Come on. Come on, buddy. Come on.
Fucking Matthew Broderick. Come on. I'm watching the football right now. Come on, go.
Oh my God, whatever. Dude, he was great in fucking Cable Guy as well.
Wide-eyed blandness, man. Okay, is he gonna do, let's see if he fucking sells the gay romance shit.
He's a straight man.
What are they gonna do?
He's a straight man playing a gay man.
Oh, here
we
go.
He's a gay straight man in this.
Hold on. I will forgive all of his blandness if he could pull off the gay kiss.
All right.
Let's see.
Is there anything I can do?
You've already done more than you know.
They shot it at the cheat angle.
So, that is kind of lame. Cheated it. He didn't actually kiss him.
He didn't do it. He just fucking put his head in front of the other dude's head.
See, you remember what I told you? That it looked like he was like really uncomfortable in that picture where he played a gay guy on stage? And the other guy looked like he was really leaning into the camera. I don't know if that guy, the other guy playing opposite him, was actually gay or not, but whatever, he did a better job at leaning into it than Matthew did. So you can tell he's icked out by the gay. It's probably that Catholic upbringing, dude. It's probably that
bitter homophobe.
He's filled with all that Catholic guilt and shit, and he can't do that. You know,
fucking Catholic. All right, so. He also had some other roles. He was Peter on The Conners, Michael Burr on Daybreak, and Joseph Sugarman on BoJack Horseman, which actually was pretty good as a voice actor in that, I will admit.
I haven't seen that one.
So let's talk about Jimmy Fallon's TV roles, which he's been more of a TV guy. Most of his roles are just playing himself. He appears as himself on at least 21 shows. One of the only shows where Fallon does not play himself, oddly enough, is on Sesame Street here. So I'll go around 25 seconds into this. You can see him. I don't know what he plays here.
He's coming down on a rope!
Well, here I am. I've been dropped out here in the middle of nowhere with only the clothes on my back to see if I can survive out here in the wilds of nature.
Okay, so he's playing some kind of like, what's that dude that fucking does that show where, but he's doing it on Sesame Street, you know? So I don't know. He's like a nature survivalist, but he's on Sesame Street, so, you know, it's easy to survive there or whatever.
He's ripping off Steve Irwin, but just doing it in the blandest, most fucking uninteresting way. Like, the puppets are trying to hype it up, but he's really just making it sound like a snooze fest of a fucking trip. Like, if I was a kid watching this episode, thank goodness, by the way, that... When I was a child, Jimmy Fallon was also still too young to be on Sesame Street. You know what I mean? He hadn't been discovered yet.
Thankfully.
In the 80s or whatever. He hadn't made his way over there yet. Because fuck this episode.
He was also on The Electric Company.
What is
another,
that?
Kid show.
It's like a kid show. All right, let's see how he is in this.
Absolutely horrible. Instantly.
Oh my fucking God. My dick just retreated back into my body for a second.
Right,
that move that he's doing, we gotta watch this whole shit.
Dude, Paul's dick is turtling.
Oh my god, come back out, dick. Oh my God, this is so uncomfortable.
Oh man, dude. What the fuck? Let's slow it down.
I can't. No, TJ. Oh my God. No, God. Look at how fucking uncomfortable he is. Look at how fucking uncomfortable he is.
Dude, I thought I'd actually see someone that has less rhythm than me. I finally found it. So, I mean, like, that's, you know what? There's one good thing from this episode. There's a fucking silver lining.
Oh my god!
I look how he's like looking down the whole time, like he's just like, okay, just get through it. He's paycheck.
He's trying to look at himself on the monitor so he can see how gawky and awkward and fucking out of place he looks trying to be hip hop over here.
Get through this shit. Get your fucking check. Get the fuck up out of here, Jimmy. Like, just another fucking paycheck.
It's for the kids, Jimmy. It's for the kids. 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 Just get through it. Turn your back a little bit. Yeah, you can shake your butt a little bit. It's a kid show. You
know. Let's watch it. High speed. The charge is electric and all you gotta do is plug it in. Plug it in. So imagine the world with everything around you. Every second sounds will establish you somehow. Before you know it, even you'll have the power to bring the world to life. That's right. Hey. What we do with you?
This is weaponized cringe.
Oh, that face. Look at his face. Look at the shit-eating grin he's got on right now.
Oh, my God. I wish somebody with a big fucking, like, size 12 work boot would come out and just fucking plant it right in that face. Just pop! Oh, my God.
Well, I feel like he's looking right at you, Jimmy.
He is. He's looking right at me. Smiling right because he makes more money in a year. He makes more money in a year than I'll make in my entire life fucking put together, and that's what he's looking at me telling me right now. Oh yeah, you make fun of me all you want, but the reason I did this is because I'm a big name and like they wanted me on the show and I did this for the kids and I didn't even get paid for it, you dumb fuck. And I make fucking I could buy and sell you and everybody else on your cheap shit little show because I'm Jimmy fucking fuck you. I work on the fucking Tonight Show. I succeeded fucking Jay Leno. I'm the man that fucking runs the late night game now, bitch. And who are you? Who are you? A nobody burger with no cheese and no condiments, motherfucker. Just one single little leaf of lettuce. And I'm Jimmy. Fuck you. I was on Saturday Night Live and I've been in fucking actual movies, Fallon. Right? That's what he's saying to me. Is it not radiating that to you or am I just crazy?
No, it's 100% radiating every word of that. Jimmy Fallon's net worth is $60 million, by the way.
Oh, my God. He could buy and sell every one of our pimply asses, dude. Up and down the river. Dude, he could make a phone call right now, and we'd all be working for him.
And, of course, his most famous role is as the host of The Tonight Show. Here is a compilation of all of his horrible fake laughs.
Watch if you want to cringe. I'm so excited when I tell them.
In New York. That's the funniest fucking shit. Wow. Now he's doing the fist one.
Dude, so I get it. So Jimmy Fallon's job is to make it plausible that someone will laugh at these bad jokes.
Laugh at insipid celebrities. Fake. Laugh at insipid celebrities. Do 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 do.
I guess we're getting paid like $10 million a year. It's worth
what this motherfucker is the true master of. The fake laugh at the thing that's not even remotely funny. Just to like, oh, oh man, wow.
Oh man, this hurts. This episode hurts on my bones.
Good.
Thank you. It may take me a couple months to. I'm approaching that funny, dude. That's like a little, like, at most in a real conversation, okay.
Yeah, it's like real life. Be like, oh.
Rectum, I almost killed him.
Oh, Paul.
Oh, Paul.
No, Jimmy. No. It's great to be here. It's great. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Jimmy.
I'm being stitches, Paul. So funny.
Oh, somebody get Jimmy. Somebody get Jimmy some tissues. It's okay, Jay. I love you too. Oh, man. Oh, wow. Oh, always great to be here with you, Jimmy. Always great. Yeah. I love it on the D list. Yeah, I really do.
Oh, what's she been through? Wow. Oh, hold on, Paul. Hold on. Oh, you're too funny.
God, stop. Just stop, dude. Fuck. Just don't know how to thank
you. It may take me a couple months. That was the same one. Me and the people I was walking with, and he goes, Robert DeCunny. David Duchovny's like, what is this guy doing?
He's like, man, that's the fucking most, that's the shittiest fucking fake laugh ever, dude. What a dumb fuck.
Because you know what it is? It's like, no matter what the situation is, he's always going to act like the joke was a 10 out of 10. Like the least reaction you'll get out of a joke is that desk hit. So he's like, he has three levels where it's like, or he has the one where he slaps the desk, which is a little high. Like, and then there's the clap one, which like you only, if you say something that's actually funny that even warrants a chuckle, that's when you get to like, and they'll touch you. Oh my God.
Have you guys ever laughed? I don't know how much you watch of this show. I've seen some
very, very, very little.
Have you ever laughed at anything Jimmy Fallon has said on The Tonight Show?
I don't think so.
I don't think so. Maybe.
Yeah, neither have I.
I can't recall a moment. I mean, I'm not saying this never happened, but I don't really watch his shit, so I don't know.
Yeah, I don't watch The Tonight Show.
Fucking Christ, man.
A laugh and the clap. Yeah, that's about it. So let's take a look at another clip real quick. This one is... 50 seconds, and this him playing, this is some sketch comedy. I don't want to play too much of this, but I'll play it. We'll give you a little taste.
Everyone in town loves my tight pants. I got my tight pants. I got my tight pants on.
There you go. The cringy dancing thing is like, that's he just does it. It's all over the place, I guess. He loves it. He loves it.
TJ?
Yeah, what's up?
Why are you doing this to me?
Because I love you, Paul. I love you so much. I just want to share this with you. Here's a ooh with John Cena.
Okay.
They play two. Well, here you go.
Oops. I guess I'm stronger than I thought.
Allison, now that you're back at school, have you been talking to any boys?
Yes. Check out this text.
What? With my crush. Hold on, I'm trying to get this fucking... The fuck is this?
Man, you fucking suck, TJ.
What the fuck?
Boo! Boo!
Shut up. You know what the next one, dude?
I just want to go into fucking theater mode.
Arrow, TJ. Hey. Sup?
Lessons are coming up. You want to practice our routine?
Oh! Hit it.
It's funny because it's John Cena.
Now they're going to do a cringy dance again.
Are they doing another cringy dance? Yeah, they are. This is 90% of what Jimmy Fallon does. It's like, I'm white and I can't dance, yet I'm going to.
It's funny because they're boys, but they're in dresses. Ha, 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 ha.
They're dressed like girls.
Boys are dressed like girls. Ha, 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 ha. Boys are act like girls. Ha, 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 ha.
And look. Him have big muscles, so it's an even bigger comedic contrast, you know?
Him like, have big muscles, and most girl not have big muscle.
Oh, I had some funny shit, boy.
How many views on this, TJ? Like 10 million?
13.6 million views,
13
Scotty.
13 million.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It's beloved by the people. 285,000 thumbs up, only 6,000 thumbs down.
What a sack of fucking shit.
Let me add to them thumbs up.
What
I
a
think
sack of fucking shit.
Video has more likes, TJ, than we even have fucking subscribers, dude.
Exactly.
Think about that. Think about
gold.
That.
By like a huge margin.
Yeah, Jimmy Fallon whips the fucking shit out of us, dude. This is what people beautiful. Want. It's what they it's want, beautiful. Paul. You're talking shit, Paul? The people have spoken. 13 million views, man. They love it.
They love it.
If the people have spoken in this, they have indeed spoken out of their rear fucking ends, dude. They've blown a fucking trumpet blast of stinky putrid air into the world.
So here's a sketch from his the time Trump was
on
the
show.
Oh,
where he does his hack Trump impersonation?
Yeah, with Trump actually there with him.
Me right. Interviewing me, that's what I call a great idea.
Woo!
That's a great idea. We thought of it.
What the fuck?
That is the most hack Trump that I've ever fucking heard in my life. He should be ashamed of himself.
Easy. I'll challenge them to the biggest game of Jenga ever. I'll make them set up the board. And then when they finish, I'll say, I don't want to play anymore.
There you go. There you go.
Oh my God. You know what would make this sketch awesome? If a dude with a giant, like a dude wearing a bloody butcher's apron and like a pig's head mask busted through the wall with a chainsaw and lopped Fallon's head off and just showered Trump in his blood, that would be fucking hilarious, dude. And the realer, the better, you know what I mean? You know what I mean? In Minecraft, the realer, the better.
In that old mine.
Dude, Jimmy Fallon is so not committed to this fucking sketch. Look at his fucking
I want to beat him over the head in an alley and not even rob him. You know what I mean? Like, I want to see him walking through an alley and I want to give him the blackjack and then just leave him there with his wallet and let the fucking other bums pick him clean. You know what I mean? Just look at him. Look at him. Look at this hack ass fucking Donald Trump that he did. Hack Trump.
He's a fucking hack bum. Trump.
Dude, didn't we watch a good ass fucking Donald Trump impersonation the other day something?
Yeah.
Like a person that actually knows how to do a good Trump.
Yep. Yeah.
Wasn't he like fucking like put on Saturday SNL for his fucking impersonations? Yeah.
Yes. So the master of impersonations. Are you guys what? What are you guys saying? This is
His best impersonation?
No, Pee Wee Herman, of course. His first one, dude. That's how he broke into the biz. He did Pee Wee Herman. He does Trump. I mean, look, he's TJ.
This can't be his best. This can't be his best.
A little more, TJ. Let's hear more, man. I think he's gonna nail it.
He's gonna knock the next joke out of the park, guaranteed.
I'm gonna laugh, dude. I'm committed to laughing, TJ.
Committed. Hold on. Hold up.
Are you lost, TJ? Do you know what's going on?
I'm trying to. I was just looking up the impersonate. Paul wanted to know what he's
You're
fucking
liar,
impersonating.
TJ.
I'm trying to find
that
what
shit. You're lying, TJ. You're lying.
Fine. Watch this stupid shit then.
Thank you.
You want to know something? That's genius.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, that's great. Anyway.
Great, man.
Not only that, but he actually, like, this TV appearance, like, really humanized Trump and shit. And this was before the election and shit.
Yeah, so he helped.
So he really fucking...
Jimmy Fallon
really
tussled Trump's hair.
Yeah, he did. He was like, you scamp.
Oh, Trump, come here.
We love each other. We kiss each other.
Trump put
You're
extra glue.
You're a good authoritarian piece of shit.
Little glad-handing Jimmy Fallon.
Dude, Jimmy Fallon was in on the fix, TJ. He knew Trump was going to win. He's like, got to butter up Trump for this cycle. Get some good ratings.
Oh, dude, sucking the balls of people is what he does best, dude. It didn't matter if it was Trump's balls. He's just a big suction hole for balls. He doesn't care. He doesn't care whose balls it is. Just like a big sucking mouth. Just instantly ready to accept
any. He doesn't matter which ball it is.
It doesn't matter. You don't even have to be up.
Dirty ball, sweaty ball, nasty ball.
Be like a homeless guy or something. He'll be like, maybe I'll suck his balls just in case he's done someday.
As long as the ball goes in the hole. Doesn't
Dude,
matter.
He sucks lady balls too. Tonight's guest, Speaker of the House, Nancy Pelosi. Working those balls.
I love them Pelosi balls. Love them Donald Trump balls. Love all the balls in the world. I'm Jimmy Fallon. Put them in my mouth. He's Mr. Bucket, dude. Puts the balls in his mouth.
Mr. Bucket. Put your balls in my mouth. Mr. Bucket.
Mr. Bucket.
Oh, my God.
Put your ball in me. I'm Jimmy Fallon.
Mr. Bucket. He's about his life. He's about as full of life as that fucking piece of broken shit.
I'd rather look at Mr. Fucking Bucket's creepy ass in my house. If I had to wake up and it's like, you can see the face of Jimmy Fallon, or you can see the face of Mr. Bucket. I'm taking Mr. Bucket, dude. I'm like, whoa, fuck. Jimmy Fallon, God. You're not going to get that fucking image burned out of your fucking brain.
Dude, Femi Jallon, it's time for you to retire, dude. It's time for Femi Jallon to retire, dude. Get out of here, Fimmy.
I got out of here, Fimmy
Jallon, boy. Fimmy, Fimmy,
the legend of Fimmy Jallon.
Fimmy, Fimmy, Fimmy.
The search for Fimmy Jallon.
He comes late at night, children.
I fucking
on the TV. He speaks to you. He fake laughs. Don't watch.
I hate the empty, desolate blandness of Matthew Broderick, but if we're doing cringe,
this wins.
Jimmy Fallon's gotta win, right?
Give him another one. I told you this is gonna be a lopsided fucking clubbing, dude. I know Jimmy Fallon. Matthew Broderick has done some cringy shit, but not.
I wanted to kayfabe the ball, but you're right. There's no fucking content so far.
And the problem is when you go through the fucking Matthew Broderick shit, it's bland and it's uninteresting, and you kind of just like, all right, he's bland and lame. And then you go to Jimmy Fallon stuff, and there's so much there. It's just,
and
like,
you're just
so cringe.
Well, it's active. Undeniable cringe.
Yeah.
Like real world, undeniable cringe that I guarantee you at least 75% of the people that watch this show experience, like, physically. I know I do.
I will say that if it was a contest of I said it was the battle of the blands. So if there's a blandness meter, I would say Matthew Broderick. But if we're doing cringe, which I feel like you got to do cringe.
This is like the fine line of cringe, dude. This really is the it fucking blows you away how bad this is, but also at the same time how popular it is. At this, I mean,
like
normally some shit like this would have no legs. It would have no fucking legs.
What would you rather have, TJ? A bland evening talking to fucking like Noam Chomsky.
Yeah. Bland, yeah.
Or like or an evening with Egghead, you know what I mean? Like right. Pick your poison, man. You know what I mean?
Right. All right, so let's talk about film work. So Matthew Broderick, obviously, most of his roles have been on film. He's more of a film or stage actor than he is a television actor. So
yeah.
Some of the roles he's known for here: Ferris Bueller's Day Off, which, you know, unironically good movie.
It's a good movie.
Cable Guy also a great movie.
Good movie.
It's, you know, he's a straight man in that. Jim Carrey kind of carries the movie, but you know, you need some kind of straight man.
Still, yeah, I mean, whatever. He's fine.
He works in the role. War Games. Have I even seen that?
Dude, I've seen War Games a bunch of times. It's from the 80s. You've probably seen it. If you haven't, you should watch it. It's really interesting. But he's good in it. Yeah, it's a good movie.
I really didn't care for the Broderick version of the producers, but I have a pretty strong affinity for the original.
I mean, I'll say this. It's not nowhere near as good as the original, but it's definitely it's passable.
I mean, it's not horrible or nothing, I guess.
Yeah.
So let's take a little closer look at some of these movies here. So we have Ferris Bueller's Day Off, which, you know, we'll just take a little bit of the trailer here.
Why should he get to skip school when everybody else has to go?
Syphilitic meningitis.
He never gets caught.
This guy in my biology class said that if Ferris dies, he's giving his eyes to Stevie Wonder.
Well, he's very popular.
He's very popular.
Line.
Popular, Ed.
I recall Central Park in fall.
Ferris Bueller, do you know him?
Yeah, he's getting me out of summer school.
They think he's a righteous dude.
Think he'll be alive this weekend?
I can see him.
This is a well done trailer because
it has no Matthew Broderick in it.
Yeah, and also they're more like just selling like the character through other people's perceptions of him rather than like showing a lot of him.
It's building hype and expectation, right?
Jeopardizes my ability to effectively govern this student body.
He does whatever he wants.
You know, as long as I've known him, everything works for him.
Whenever he wants.
He's very cool.
And he never gets nailed.
Ferris can do anything.
Oh, he's such a sweetie.
Wake up and smell the coffee, Mrs. Bueller. It's a fool's paradise. He is just leading you down the primrose path.
Matthew Broderick. Bueller. Ferris Bueller.
Yeah, they did use very minimal Broderick in that trailer, which might have been
I think intelligently, though, because they're building up the hype around the movie and
right.
The character that gets away with everything and he's in high school.
This is a great example of tell don't show,
right?
Which is usually the reverse of what you want to do, but
so
I think
this,
it works here.
This movie works on a number of levels. It's really funny. It's a good slice of life for that like 80s teenager thing. If you like John Hughes, I don't think this is a John. Is this a John Hughes movie?
I believe it is.
I think it is, but I'm not 100%. It doesn't really matter.
It kind of has his feel.
It definitely has that his eye for capturing the the kind of fashion and attitude of kids of the 80s and that were in high school and shit. And yeah, so it has all that shit going, but it also managed to be genuinely touching and address some really harsh issues about parents and their expectations and how those affect their children and, the desire to individuate yourself from the expectations of others is explored. How hard it is to be in a relationship is explored. The complicated nature of friendships, it's a great movie. Like any movie that can be funny and evoke interesting messages about the human condition is...
Well, John Hughes was pretty much knocking that shit out of the park in the 80s.
Like, right.
All of his movies kind of had that going on. They were all like, they're funny on a surface level, but they have like some deeper meanings.
Did you look it up? It is a John Hughes film?
It is, yeah.
Okay, yeah, I thought it was. I just made sure. Trailer.
Yeah, he wrote and directed it and all that shit, so yeah.
Yeah, I'm just making sure.
Yep, 100%. All right, so this is him talking about his role in The Lion King. They chose a very strange picture of Simba for the background because it looks like Simba's like about to get blown or something, but whatever.
Well, it was very, very exciting because having only been in a little dark, isolated...
God, what is he, like 2 feet tall?
He's a small guy for sure. He's not a big guy.
Dude, I expect him to peel off that goatee at any moment.
I know, right? It looks like something he could just go, like, rip, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Do you remember the fucking episode of Star Trek where fucking Thomas Riker pulls off the, like, fake...
The sideburns.
Like, the fake sideburns, like, ha-ha!
I remember also going to the Star Trek convention, and none of us were all too chicken shit to be like...
Yeah, I wanted to go ask him about that, but none of us fucking had the balls to do it, so whatever. I
haven't really seen any of it until the finished product.
What do you think about Tribbles?
The opening scene, which is...
What is your position on Tribbles, Broderick?
He's pretty bland in fucking interviews, too.
I know, he's so...
Initial feelings on the project were kind of mixed. I didn't know what to expect, but as soon as I met the talented cast and crew...
Great,
all of the animators...
Circle of Life or something. I don't know. It's like a movie.
I'm in all the circle of life right now.
It's
if you really think about it, it's
pointy shoes do this these drawings. I was never there, so it's
I've never been there, dude. I was never there. Should be written on my tombstone. On Matthew Broderick. I was never there, dude. I'm gonna write that on my tombstone. I was never there.
Oh no.
Go gadget shit on your childhood. Here it comes, folks. This bland adaptation of a nonsense fucking cartoon from your childhood. Here it is.
Oh my god.
This is just such dog shit. I don't even want to. Do we have to do this? Do we have to watch this?
That's Dr. Claw, by the way.
I know. Dr. Claw is not supposed to be. They should have kept his face hidden.
Not only that, but even if he had a face, would you ever have fucking seen that? You know what I mean?
Dr. No. Claw. So where's the character have? He's evil. That's a fucking claw. Also,
I don't even really. I mean, that's a claw. It's like a clamp.
Dr. Clamp. facing down against his facing down against his most feared foe, Dr. Penis Pincher.
It's and fucking Andy Dick is
what?
In it.
What? No!
Yeah, no.
Oh, dude, is that Andy Dick?
It is. I just said that.
Can get any worse? No.
And then a random Andy Dick shows up.
Wait, I want to tell you guys something. For $100, you can get Andy Dick to say whatever you want.
Are you serious? Okay.
Yeah, he's on that cameo site for like $100. You can just like get him to do like.
Could we write like a fucking like screed and be like, "Hi, read this, Andy. Hi, I'm Andy Dick. I'm an alcoholic failure that everyone hates because I fucking ruin every friendship that I've had and I piss on every connection I've ever had and I'm out of control. And one day somebody's gonna find me dead, and only about half the amount of people that I think will care will actually care. And there'll be a lot of people in my life, especially that'll be
relieved. He probably won't fucking do that. You know,
there's no way. Why wouldn't he? No. If I pay my $100, he better do it or I'm suing his ass.
I think they'll just be like, we're not accepting this commission or whatever.
I'll appeal it to the fucking higher court.
Yeah, the highest court in the land.
I'll take it straight to the Supreme Court. Shit. I'll take it to The Hague. I'll take it in front of the fucking international community, TJ.
Hell yeah.
And he's got a gadget of his own. An evil gadget.
Looks so real.
Robo gadget.
He looks just like me.
Robo gadget apparently is gone berserk in the downtown Riverton area.
Reports indicate that he's already caused a major traffic accident.
Go home and lock your doors.
And set fire to an elderly man's beard.
Walt Disney Pictures presents a hero.
You know how to dance, don't you?
I was taking lessons.
Shut up and dance!
Who's got gizmos up the wazoo.
A moment of silence for our reality.
Man, the fucking Berenstain universe really is a cruel, fucking harsh mistress to live in, dude.
It is, dude.
Now you know something's lame when they have, like, cool shit, like, depraved shit, like they're blowing shit up and shooting shit, but it just feels lame. And you just like, it's like, no,
It's garbage.
See, that's like, it's bullshit violence, dude. There's nothing visceral about it. It's like, no, dance! Oh,
I love how, like,
Broderick dance, great, of course, just what I paid for.
I love how Matthew couldn't pull off anything other than the blandness of Inspector Gadget, and so they had to put a big set of fake teeth in him to make him not look totally fucking bland. Like, he couldn't play an evil version of the same character. Like, most actors would fucking jump at that chance, but it looks like Matthew Broderick probably struggled, so they had to...
I will say this. Somehow... he's worse as the villain Gadget.
No, I believe it, because it's the one he's least comfortable with.
Yeah, like, at least when it comes to Inspector Gadget, like, his blandness kind of works for the character a little bit, because, like, there's a naivete to Inspector Gadget that Broderick kind of can do.
Yeah.
But when he's expected to do the evil version of himself, it's like, he literally, like, goes around going, and shit. It's like, okay. No.
Yeah.
So it's like you're in school and they're like, you have to play like a drug dealer or something bad, like if you're doing Dare, and it's like, no, you're gonna sell some drugs to some kids. Hey kids, wanna buy crack? I'm evil. You know, it's like, come on, dude. Can you do something a little bit better?
No, he can't.
Go. Gadget.
But like we said before.
Is he Scottish?
I don't know.
Paul. Don't you know bad robots have more fun?
I don't know what accent he's
doing. But Paul, you, when we talked about this before, this guy's supposed to have this theater background. He can't pull off this role or anything. He can't show any little,
emotion. Like, okay, in defense of that, because I'll address that, Scotty. That's a fair point that Scotty brought up, but I think it warrants a pause, especially because a pause means I don't have to watch more of this right now. So
yeah,
that's,
there you go.
That's great. But Scotty, yeah. I mean, yeah, it's pretty fucking shit here, but... You gotta blame the people that wrote the fucking script to a certain extent and conceptualize the whole thing, right? Like, an evil robot Inspector Gadget comes to menace Inspector Gadget. Like, that's a pretty fucking asswipe idea, and I'm pretty sure it didn't originate with Matthew Broderick. So
I don't think it did.
A movie this bad doesn't really happen because of any one person. Like, there's a lot of fucking...
What about hiring like a 25-year-old guy that looks like a normal dude to play fucking Dr. Claw? You think that had anything to do? You see what I'm saying? Like, yeah, he's shit in this, but this whole thing is shit. Like, maybe he half-hearted it because
his
it was just a paycheck.
His car is a D.L. Hughley, by the way. He's driving around a D.L. Hughley-voiced car.
Oh, wow. Yeah,
it's that bad. This is I don't even know what this is. This is Deck the Hall.
Oh, no, TJ, no.
What the fuck are you doing to us, man?
TJ, this is real bad.
You're a fucking monster, TJ.
Town of Cloverdale. Stephen
Finch. Lives a bland, uninteresting man that no one cares about.
You have to have a game plan. All must-sing Caroline requests to be submitted in writing.
Until the competition.
Did he just say all must sing caroling has to be submitted in writing?
So can I just spoil this for you? So this is like an attempt to capture the kind of like from two different worlds energy that is in National Lampoon's Christmas Vacation, right? Where
And it's
remember when his cousins
succeeds wonderfully at it, I'm sure.
You're right. When his cousins come to visit and they're all crazy and shit. Yes, it succeeds absolutely in capturing that really funny, really relatable kind of culture clash. As you guys will see. You'll see. Watch.
I believe you.
You'd be blown away, TJ. You'll be fucking blown away.
I'm getting ready. I'm Buddy Hall. We just moved in across the street. Oh, man. Really? They're going to fuck up? Oh.
I'm Buddy Hall. We just moved in across the street. Somehow I still have a career. I'm Danny DeVito. Hey, everybody. I'm short and weird.
Hey, dude.
I like Danny DeVito. I don't want to see this.
Defense. He's kept it going, Paul. He's kept it going.
Yeah.
Many have fallen before him.
You can see every house in the country from space.
Where's our house?
You can't see our house.
Just hoping that one day I'd do something big.
Okay.
Buddy.
Around here, I'm the Christmas guy.
I don't think so. No.
So wait, they're going to get into a Christmas
spirit. Yeah, it's like grumpy old men. And then, like, I shit you not, you know the whole movie now that you know the premise.
I do, yeah.
Because they fucking compete back and forth in ever absurd, more absurd.
Right, and it continues to escalate. Right,
more grandiose right. ways. And then they both come to the realization that they've lost sight of what Christmas is about, which is neighbors loving neighbors and families loving families. And then they get together and they come together and they make the most awesome Christmas thing ever for the town. And that's the movie.
And they love happily ever.
Yep.
Watch and learn.
For the holidays.
It's gonna swell up.
But the holidays.
Got the next 5 years of trees all lined up.
How'd you like to chop it down with my chainsaw? Might not be big enough.
Does anyone smell gas?
For the both of them.
I guess
that defies everything I know about physics, but. Whatever.
He hit that wood and it
cracked a melon, so I don't know.
Yeah. No, he hit that wood and it chucked a spark, dude.
Yeah, and then lit the entire. Because
you know how wood, creates its own sparks and shit when hit by metal and stuff. Usually, you know how it works. Yeah. That axe chucked a spark off of that wood and lit all that gas up, man. It happened. Hey.
Why do you guys think logging is so dangerous? If you try to cut down a tree, guys, most trees light on fire immediately.
They immediately burst, and the whole thing too burst into flames. Yeah.
Christmas ever.
We're gonna settle this like men.
They're acting like a bunch of 12-year-olds.
You want lights? I'll give you lights.
Oh gosh. SpongeBob, this is SquarePants. Come in.
You sure you've been watering that?
TJ. Ha 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 ha.
Regency Enterprises presents Danny DeVito.
I really want my house to be seen. From space.
Matthew Broderick.
I like the way you've duct taped the antlers to their heads. Apparently, reindeer are not indigenous to the region.
Okay.
Yeah. I'm kind of the Christmas guy around here. No, I don't think so. Where I'm from, I'm the Christmas guy. Well, I guess we're enemies now, aren't we? Yeah, I guess we are.
Like this video?
Let's get into ridiculously escalating conflict that alienates us from the town and our families until we realize the error of our ways.
Oh, you mean one that eventually wraps back around on itself and teaches us the value of not only our budding friendship, but Christmas as a whole?
Yes, indeed. I do mean that. Let us do it.
Then the fight is on, then, asshole.
My lights will be brighter than your lights, sir.
They'll be the brightest together.
What a nightmare. Oh, my God.
They basically took one of the terrible subplots from The Grinch and made an entire movie out of it with Danny DeVito and
no.
Matthew Broderick. So. Terrible concept, terrible movie, whatever. Okay, Jimmy Fallon time. What are we going to do? Okay.
It's going to be.
So here's Jimmy Fallon. He's got some films under his belt as well.
I've seen Taxi, and it's beyond terrible.
He's got some films under that belt. Not too many, but not, you know, too little. We can, we'll just jump right into them. I don't need to fucking do this shit. So this is Taxi. This is
no.
Queen Latifah.
No.
Queen motherfucking Latifah.
No.
That's right, Paul.
Officer Washburn is having a bad day.
Nobody bought that mustache anyway, so him ripping it off isn't funny.
Officer Washburn.
That's funny.
Is having a bad month.
Three cars you total. That is 11 points on your license.
Don't take my license, please.
It's gone.
Oh, so it's this movie, the renegade fucking cop movie, right?
Yeah.
That has to go find a real job. Becomes a taxi driver, but he still finds out he can fight crime when he's out in the taxi.
No, that's not the premise, dude.
No, it's not.
Premise is that he has to take cabs everywhere, and he gets Queen Latifah to drive him around, and she's just a cab driver.
The buddy cop movie.
He kind of becomes his buddy cop in this.
I'm too old for this shit, Riggs.
Luckily for Officer Washburn.
Well, he just killed half the town, so, you know.
And provided an amazing metaphor for his career, too.
Washburn, he lives in New York City.
36 and Broadway. Step on it.
You jumped in the right cab today.
I don't usually stop for white guys. My way of balancing the universe.
I forgot this happened.
What is this?
Yeah.
What is this? She has a men in black car or whatever.
Yep, that's right.
Don't you know super cabs exist?
Yeah, there you go.
It's now a race car.
Well, it is a race car. Get it?
Queen Latifah. Jimmy Fallon.
Cop. Hood rat. Clash together, forced to work together to fight the criminal. Who will make you fall asleep first? Will it be Queen Latifah playing Queen Latifah again in a movie, or will it be Jimmy No Talent Fallon? Oh my God, what a fucking nightmare. What a hideous fucking travesty of a nightmare. And at least they're playing Highway to Hell over the last part of it. So I had to
turn it down for that reason because I thought.
I know.
The only good thing about the fucking trailer, dude.
It's been
you.
The silence, the sound of silence, dude.
Actually, fuck YouTube. I know it's not you personally. That's
when you watch on this, when you watch this movie, you're on the Highway to Hell, dude.
I'm on a highway to cringe.
What? That makes no sense.
Highway to cringe.
I'm on a highway to cringe. All right.
Watch Jimmy Fallon cringe my pants.
I take you've never seen this movie then, Paul.
I've never seen it because it has Jimmy Fallon and Queen Latifah in it, and I'm not fucking stupid, and I realize that clock is ticking, you know, on my life, and I got better shit to do.
I watched this movie when it came out in 2004.
Well, that was a stupid fucking move. I wouldn't admit that in public again.
I did it.
Why?
I don't know. I didn't even know who Jimmy Fallon was at the time, so
gross.
I had no forewarning. And Queen Latifah had not been in a bunch of shit yet either. So they were both kind of new, so I didn't really know yet that they were fucking to be avoided.
Queen Latifah's been good in a couple of things, but Jimmy Fallon's never been good in a fucking thing, dude.
Yeah. I would say Queen Latifah gives a pretty standard Queen Latifah performance in this, so it's like, whatever.
Dude, Set It Off is a good movie.
I don't know if I've seen that.
Dude, you have to see that movie. Set It Off is a really good
flick. I've seen Taxi, though.
See, you've seen Taxi, but you've never seen Set It Off?
Yeah. What
kind of 90s kid are you, dude?
I have no idea. So this is Fever Pitch. Oh, this is terrible. I saw this, too. My dad dragging
no,
it.
Oh, man, no, man, no.
Come on, TJ. Fuck you, dude.
Pager, nothing?
No.
Well, what if some sudden crisis occurs, like your father has a heart attack or something?
Oh,
I'm sorry.
I just...
just found out this morning, so it's been a rough 24 hours. You know, maybe I should get a cell phone. That's a good idea.
Oh my God, no.
Oh my God, that was some great acting.
No. No, Jesus God, no. Jesus God, no. Jesus God, no. All right. I've never met a guy quite like Ben. Really? It seems like he's pretty standard.
Yeah,
I don't know. It
seems like your standard, everyday, average, fucking nobody asshole that you hope doesn't pull you aside in any social situation, basically.
Yeah. She's
never met one of those guys? Where'd she grow up? Fucking Antarctica? Like, what the fuck? Those guys are a dime a dozen everywhere I've been, but whatever.
He's so unique and different. In what way?
Well, he's like, so quirky. Like, he makes jokes and stuff, Scotty. He's so quirky. I've never met a guy quite like him.
It's looks a quirka.
And instead of becoming more open and available, I'm becoming less open.
All the guys you date are competitive and successful. It's like you're dating yourself.
Ding, ding, ding.
This guy has got such a good vibe. I really think you've got something.
Yeah, he's got a good vibe, man.
He's not quite right.
Robin, there is a reason this Ben guy is still single.
I'm really going to take a chance now. Lindsay, will you go to opening day with me?
Yes.
So the premise of this movie is this dude seems perfect, but it turns out he's a super big fucking baseball fan.
What?
Yeah.
No movie needed. Like, I'm really into baseball. Okay.
But he's too into it. He's too into it, Scotty.
He's a fan.
Where do the Sox rank in your life?
I say Red Sox and breathing.
Can you believe this pinhead?
She knows he's devoted.
This what?
It's an obsession. I know. It's just that I hate when it becomes... Oopsie.
But she's about to discover.
They're sending me to Paris to close the deal. And I am taking...
Just how committed he really is.
Why would anybody ever choose Jimmy Fallon to take to Paris with them? You know what I mean? That the movie falls apart right there as a plot. Plot hole alert right here in your trailer. Nobody would willingly...
Guy from earlier, I don't know.
Like if Jimmy Fallon was in a crowd of other fucking A-list celebrities to be picked for dodgeball, he would be the last kid standing. He would have to like sub in if somebody pulled their fucking hammy or something. Like, nobody would, not even a girl that was into him would choose to go to Paris with him. So,
also, by the way, just a really stupid premise for a fucking movie.
So, there's what is it that, no, wait a minute. He's too into the Red Sox. That's it.
Yeah, that's it.
Yeah.
And he's got to learn to, like, grow up and, like,
what? Give him the boot. At what point do you say to yourself, I'm counting on you to be the one, and I have no fallback plan?
It's not another woman. It's an entire team.
Wow. Wow. Was that intended?
I was imagining the Red Sox.
I gotta do it, Jimmy Fallon.
Oh my God. It's not another woman.
Our biggest fan is here.
It's an entire team.
It's the entire bench of the Boston Red Sox running a train on Jimmy Fallon's prolapsed asshole.
I see the problem now. I see the problem now with that relationship.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a better premise for a movie, by the way. Better premise.
Oh, come on.
Better premise.
Oh,
better
what? Premise.
Go hit. Go swing the bat.
Drew Barrymore. Jimmy Fallon.
23 years. You still care about anything you cared about 23 years ago?
It's only a game.
What did you just say?
Fever pitch.
One family, Frank?
One, please.
Good. Now hit it again and hit Jimmy Fallon in the head and they win this movie.
Have a little ricochet. Hit Jimmy Fallon. Kill him. Yeah. Hope he's over.
Kill them both.
One fell swoop.
The dead.
Just a line drive right through both of their fucking empty fucking domes and then roll credits.
They're fucking dead. Hey, you guys, my God.
I didn't think Jimmy would. Dude, I thought you were playing dirty pool, pulling some of fucking Broderick shit, but I thought that there's no way Jimmy's going to be it. But Jimmy's already getting this point, too. This is the worst shit I've ever seen.
Oh, Dougal again?
Dougal?
Oh, dude, was in Dougal?
Dougal,
no.
Dude.
Hey, no, no, Dougal no, 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 no,
no.
He's in Dougal, man. He's in Dougal. We already seen the trailer before, but so he. The adventure of a lifetime. He's the rabbit. Let's see if the rabbit says anything here.
Come on. Three stones to rule the world. My prince.
Who up in here?
God damn it. They've let the rabbit talk. Well, whatever. He's the rabbit in this shit.
That's does he do the precious cool. line?
Does he?
Go back.
He just did it. He was about to do it, and back, you fucking Peter. Skipped.
I guess I missed it.
My precious.
Kidding.
My precious.
My precious.
Kidding.
Yeah, that was so good. Oh, my God. That kidding. Impersonation was so good that I thought it was the real Gollum. And he had to say, kidding. Where did this guy get a fucking... So can you answer for me now, TJ? What impersonations is he known for? Like, what's he got?
Jerry Seinfeld, I guess he does.
Is it a good know. Seinfeld?
Okay. So I have no idea. Pull, I don't know.
Dude, if he's an impressions guy, Gollum should be, like, in his fucking back pocket, dude. He should totally have Gollum. He was so big. I mean, 2006? Come on, checks out.
His Gollum was literally shit. Saying, my precious. And everybody's like, it's Gollum. He's like, just kidding, guys. Just kidding. I'm not the real Gollum. I'm Jimmy Fallon. It's me. It's Jimmy. It's not the real Seinfeld. It's me, Jimmy. Oh, my God.
Let's see his fucking Seinfeld.
Can he actually do any?
Jerry Seinfeld critiques Jimmy's Seinfeld impression.
No. I mean, well, whatever. If that's all we can do.
My first guest is one of.
Yeah.
I always mess up. You know me so well. I want to talk about the.
I don't want to even see this.
This makes me want to puke. So thank you.
Ah, TJ came and fucking.
Any other ones? Okay, let's see.
If he's so known for it, like
Jimmy Fallon doing an audition for Saturday Night.
Oh, hey, there you go. That's the whole roster. 12 seconds.
Why can't a black man walk around, try to do a walk a
Oh, my God, no.
How did he get this job? Was it literally just a bunch of winos that showed up that day?
I don't know.
That's good. You
see me walking on here. Don't like to walk that much. Then again, I kind of like it. No. Did you ever see a guy? Because they only served it last week.
I've yet to be able to identify any of these, by the way.
Chris Rock was the first one. I don't know what these other ones are.
Hello, dogs. Scrunchy here likes to eat a certain type of food. The name of the food he likes to eat is kibbles and bits. And bits and bits.
What the fuck is going on?
What
dude?
Is this, dude?
What's going
this
on?
Really, this is really what landed him the role? He's not much of a something when he this talks. Is clearly a pass. If you're watching this is clearly like...
I see guys out there playing ball. Into the room, he acts like he's not.
Pass. Playing. Next. Thank you.
Next. Can you do a slam dance? Can you do a slam dance?
Sir, we're going to have to call the police if you don't get off the stage. Next, please. Thank you. Audition is over. Next. Can we get some security in here? Who is this guy? Didn't we see this guy last year?
You too.
All right, you too. Here we go.
Riot
out in the street. It's like a spaceship.
Is this supposed to be He cannot do impressions. All right, Counting Crows.
Hack. Ooh, ooh.
I used to date Jennifer Aniston.
He fucking sucks, dude. How the fuck did... Dude, okay. What's the blackmail he had on Lorne Michaels, dude? What's right. in his back pocket
here's,
for real that got
happened.
Him the fucking job?
He walked
in.
Sell his soul
to
sell
his soul.
I figured it all
sign
out.
Sign on the dotted line, Jimmy. And
yes,
wealth and fame and celebrity is yours.
That's it. He was a little kid. He wanted to be a comedian. He was a Catholic, so he believed in the devil. Jesus wasn't answering them prayers, and one night he summoned on the fourth the Dark Lord and signed a contract. Nope. He's like, can you make me talented? It's like, talent's overrated, kid. I can make you famous.
That's the fanciful story, TJ. Here's what really happened. One day, Jimmy Fallon crawled out of the dumpster that he lived in, right, at the time. And he'd happened to see Lorne Michaels getting head from an underage prostitute. And he was like, aha! And Lorne was like, all right, listen, Jimmy, we'll work something out. What can I do? And he said, put me on the show. Okay. Just don't tell anybody about this.
So does he just keep finding dirt on all these guys? Yep. It didn't stop with SNL. He got movie roles. Well, he got fucking The Tonight Show.
He got to the position he wanted, though. He got to the fucking Tonight Show. And once he got to The Tonight Show, he's like, I'm set. I'm going to hobnob all these celebrities. They're going to kiss my ass. I'm going to kiss their ass. I'm good.
There's definitely a segment of the population that is like continuously tuning in to see the comedy stylings of Jimmy Fallon. So what's the explanation for those people?
They're told it's funny.
They have fucking dirt on all of them. It's like, you know what it is, TJ?
Because they're told it's funny. It's like, this is funny. So people go, okay, it's funny.
Right.
Yeah.
That's it.
He is on Tonight Show, so he must be funny.
Tonight Show funny. Here he is on Jurassic World.
Hey there. I'm Jimmy Fallon. Welcome aboard the Gyrosphere, an amazing machine made possible by science. Your safety is our main concern, which is why you're behind our invisible barrier system, which protects you.
The proper reaction to watching a Jimmy Fallon video, by the way.
Being bored to tears.
Some things like Dilophosaurus venom. One drop of this can paralyze you, so watch out. Is this real? It is?
Thank God.
We can only be so lucky.
Man, I didn't realize, I forgot in the Jurassic World universe, the best possible of all endings. Fucking Jimmy Fallon slowly suffocating as he's laying there fucking paralyzed on Dilophosaurus venom, dude. Dope.
Also the fact there's an island filled with dinosaurs you can go see. So definitely a better universe.
I wish this Dyson ball thing rolled over him at some point in this movie and just crushed him into a fucking sloppy, wet, disgusting, rubbery, floppy pancake. You know what I mean? But other than that, it's a pretty good little cameo for Jimmy Fallon. He had to know they were fucking on him.
So I do hate Inspector Gadget a lot, but...
looks like it sucks.
The thing is that while I feel like I hate Matthew Broderick's fucking movies of his that I hate more, I feel like Jimmy Fallon's never done anything I like. So I got to kind of give it to him again.
I have to, too. I mean, honestly, if you want my honest fucking vote on this, taking into account the bad shit that Broderick has done, none of it rises to the level of the cringe that we've seen from Jimmy on this one. It's just like every other category.
Okay,
is it a contest?
It's been a Jimmy Fallon sweep. So the only way... Matthew Broderick can no longer win the cringe off.
Right.
He can only tie. So Matthew Broderick would have to clean up in all the other categories, and then they would be tied.
It's just not going to happen.
But I think Jimmy Fallon's got this shit locked down. I don't know if Matthew Broderick will win any of these categories of cringe.
It's a landslide for Jimmy so far. I mean, what's the next category?
The next category is other cringe.
Other cringe. Miscellaneous, yeah. Like mixed bag cringe.
Yep, that's right. So, oof. You know this lady.
Yeah, that's Sarah Jessica Parker. That's Broderick's wife.
Yep, that's right. So Matthew Broderick went and not only is he blandness incarnate, he went and married one of the cringiest actresses he possibly could marry. Here they are together telling us about some stuff I don't even know.
Let's Sarah see. Jessica Parker.
And I'm Matthew Broderick. And we are hunkered.
Ooh, he's not looking good.
Down yeah. Here together with our family at home. Which is not where we thought we'd be.
No, we thought we would be on stage at the beautiful Hudson Theater working.
It's so tough, DJ. No, stop it. Stop it. It's tough, TJ.
I don't know if we want to watch this, you guys. It's like too sad a story. I don't know.
It's too emotional for you.
Together,
just look away.
In the Broadway revival of Neil Simon's wonderful Plaza Suite, directed by our dear friend, John Benjamin Hickey.
And we hoped that this month we would get to go to the Tony.
Anyway, they suck.
And we hoped that this month we would get to go to the film festival in LA. One of the highlights of our year.
See, this is why Matthew Broderick almost has a little bit of plot armor in this fucking contest, because it's hard to even really watch him for very long. You're just like, yeah, get out of here.
Dude, he's like, you've seen A Christmas Story, right?
Yeah. He's in that, by the way, the television remake.
Well, okay, fuck that. I didn't mean to invoke that. I was talking about the original with the little brother. Like, he had no defense. He laid there like a slug. Like, that's that's fucking Matthew Broderick. That's how he's skipping through this. Like, he's not putting he's not even putting up a defense because he knows he doesn't have to because he's up against Jimmy fucking Fallon.
You know what it is, exactly.
So one of the things I should have probably pulled this, but it was already in the nostalgia critic thing, and it's already been pointed out before. But like Matthew Broderick basically did the narration on the TV production of A Christmas Story, and like his narration compared to like the original narration from the film is just fucking god awful.
Why would you ever get Broderick to do that? He doesn't have a like a really emotive voice at all,
and he flubs a bunch of lines too. Like it's almost like he's drunk towards the end.
Maybe it's almost like he's drunk in this.
Well, you know, driving in Ireland, man.
Is he drunk in this? Crazy shit.
Maybe. Let's see.
Celebrate this season and cheer on our friends and colleagues.
He is.
He's wasted, dude.
He's drunk.
It was the middle of the season.
There were great shows that had
Great shows
that had to stop before they were really finished.
Come on, he's fucked, dude.
He's drunk.
He may not be three sheets to the wind, but he's tipsy. Like he's had a few today already.
Dude. Looks like the functioning alcoholic.
Is he an alcoholic?
I don't know for certain, man. He gives me that vibe of someone that can. He can at least hold his liquor because he's definitely a little fucking toasty.
Let's see if they fucking.
Dude, they ain't gonna show nothing from the remake, are they? Best present I ever got. Well, there's that. He's talking about. Did he play the dad or something in it?
No.
Big boy by the fireplace when I woke up and I.
He's just talking. This is an interview before. No, he played the narrator. He just literally narrates.
Oh, he narrates A Christmas Story?
Yeah.
Ralphie, go and help your father change.
Here, I'll put it to one of his reads here.
For one Ralphie, go do a line of blow.
I saw all the bolts silhouetted against the moonlit sky, and then they were gone. I lost all sense of where I was and who I was with.
Oh my fucking, don't play another second of this, please. Please, no. La, I am a radiator, I don't want to hear any more of this, TJ. This is fucking, I'm married to the winner next door. She's been married 7 times before and everyone wants an entry.
I had broken the number one verboten rule. I was awfully young to die.
Sounds like he's on Quaaludes. When this read sounds like he's on lewds. I shit you not. I was too young to die. I had seen the bolts for a moment silhouetted against the traffic in the oncoming lane. It's like he's losing control of his jaw.
Let's listen to the original narration.
Here. Yeah, no, this is like just listen to.
Fudge.
Only I didn't say fudge. I said the word, the big one, the queen mother of dirty words.
That's that person reading that is just the author of the story. He's not even an actor.
Yeah, he's doing
like a 10 times better fucking read.
He just has an actual emotional connection to what he's reading, and he's not fueled by Quaaludes and Monster Energy drinks like fucking Matthew Broderick. Paul,
fucking lewd, so, man.
As mentioned in the Celebrities Who Killed People episode that we did a few months back,
Matthew Broderick. This is cringe. This is just sad.
We just established he is a drunk, so, you know, on August 5th.
No, we did not. We did not establish that he's a drunk.
Matthew killed two people.
They're dead.
Driving on the wrong side of the road in Ireland, all drunk, perhaps, maybe. He got off with a $175 fine and to this day refuses to meet with the family.
That's some cringe right there. Refusing to meet the family is cringe.
I mean, that is pretty cringe. He gets a point here for this, for sure. That's pretty major cringe, too, because it wouldn't cost him shit.
Well, wait a minute. Let's see what his competition is.
Oh, no, he wins. Jimmy wins again. Yeah, this picture alone is more cringe than everything.
This is the lamest ride at Universal, dude. This is the fucking lamest ride. There's never a line. There's never ever.
This is a ride.
A ride. Race through New York. Race through New York, starring Jimmy Fallon, is a 3D motion simulator ride at Universal Studios Florida. Not only is the ride horrible, it is cringe as well. So it was Scotty. You remember the Twister ride or the Twister show you used to fucking love so much? This replaced that, and prior to that, it used to actually be like a Ghostbusters stage show where you got to see
which could have been really cool.
Fight the Stay Puft Marshmallow, which was apparently a really cool show.
I bet it was.
I think we saw that as kids, didn't we?
Maybe. I don't remember.
I think we saw that. I don't know.
But here's the Race Through New York ride if you want to fucking kind of see
it. Yeah, can we see what it does?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Oh, it's a 360 thing, too, so you can look around.
Here we go. In five. Turn it down a little so we can just kind of talk over it.
Oh.
So, yeah, there's Jimmy.
So you chase Jimmy Fallon through an office?
Yeah.
Yeah, through New York City.
Oh, my God. Just fucking, why would you follow him? Turn around and go somewhere cool. You're in New York City. Like, why follow Jimmy Fallon?
Run away.
Oh, my God. Is he a douche on his own ride?
Yeah.
This is so fucking cringe, dude. This is so cringe. This ride doesn't make any sense. Nobody would be following Jimmy Fallon anywhere.
Well, you're supposed to be following him to try to get to the Tonight Show or whatever. And also, like, wouldn't this be more fun if it was, like, fast and you didn't have to constantly, like, be delayed by shit? I don't know.
No, it wouldn't.
Hey, where you going? You ain't supposed to be down here.
Doesn't even look like the motion simulation is that good either. There's like two other people on here.
What are you doing?
The ride's not even full. There's like
empty seats on this motherfucker for sure. Oh shit, I didn't realize that was what you. Okay, so this is, so you can look around and see the 3D kind of effects and shit, I see. But it's Jimmy Fallon that's on the screen like 99% of the time. Like, why would I want to wait in line to look at Jimmy Fallon's stupid, vacant, empty fucking face, dude?
Going underwater now.
Oh, my God. This is just thrilling, man.
Oh, no.
Can you go back to the audience and see if we see anybody thrilled since it's a 360 video?
All right.
It's kind of hard to see them. It's a little dark back there for them, but I don't really see any. People look pretty fucking bored.
Jimmy Fallon,
Dude, that this audience looks dead.
No, bad panda. Don't do it, panda. Oh, now we're on the moon, I guess. Wow. So I thought actually when I was at Universal Studios, I was like, maybe I should go on the Jimmy Fallon ride just to like see what it's like. And now I'm glad I didn't do that.
Huh? I just woke up. Huh? What?
Maybe it's cooler in 3D.
No, it isn't. Because look what it is. It's Jimmy Fallon in 3D. Yeah. Floating in front of you.
Throwing shit, but maybe it's kind of nice that he seems close enough to punch. I don't know.
Yeah, but no, but you can't actually punch him.
That's what they should have done. They should have done Jimmy Fallon punch simulator, dude.
Abuse Jimmy Fallon, and then like the next, like, you walk to the next room and you get to shoot Jimmy Fallon in the head, and then the next room you get to like humiliate Jimmy Fallon in front of everybody. I'd wait in line for that shit. This. I wouldn't walk across the street to ride this fucking boring looking motherfucker for free, dude. Much less like waste my time at Universal doing this shit. Man, fuck this bullshit.
Oh, And then he's going to go right into his fucking stand-up
routine.
Well,
we're all glad you're good. Just kidding. We were all hoping that that thing rolled over on you and broke your neck. Well, maybe next time.
Scotty had to leave, man. He's like, I got to go.
And where the fuck does Scotty go?
Scotty left. Scotty's like, fuck this shit.
I don't blame him. The cringe apocalypse is what you've brought to us today, dude. Fucking Jimmy Fallon is going to waltz with this fucking thing, TJ. There's no way around it. Like I just, like, honestly, if I could call it for fucking Matthew,
we're not
I would.
Even done.
No,
not
I know.
Even done cringing this shit.
But I'm ready to call it already on his first one. That's the most cringe shit I've ever seen.
Had there been people who have come to you and said, Jimmy, this is working for other people. Maybe we should step into the anti-Trump lane and get in on this.
It's just not what I do. I think it'd be weird for me to start doing it now. I don't really even, you know, care that much about politics. I got to be honest. I love pop culture more than I love politics. I'm just not that brain, you know.
Do you ever feel pressure to talk about Donald Trump or to go political? Do you hear that noise?
No, I mean, I think the other guys are doing it very well. Colbert's doing great. I mean, that's what he's good at. He's great. He's always into, like, political comedy. You know, and I think when it's organic.
Here's my excuse to not alienate the Trump audience, basically.
What a fucking nightmare.
Andrew Fallon.
I'll dip into it.
Look, taking a stance on stuff is like not what I'm about, man. I'm more about like laughing at lame jokes from fucking B-list celebrities and stuff, dude. That's what I do. I'm Jim Fallon, bro.
But as well, but I've always made jokes about the president, whether, you know, we've only had Obama, but I made thousands of jokes. I remember having him on the show. I'm like, sorry, if that's my job. I have to do what I have to do, you know. But, you know, with...
Sorry, sir. I'm
sorry, Mr. Obama.
You understand there's no hard feelings, right? I just have to do that stuff, Obama. Can I kiss your ring a little more? Did anything else suck? You need your balls sucked? No? Okay. Well, if you need your balls sucked, I'm right down the hall. Just come right in anytime. Doesn't matter what I'm doing, what I'm up to. If I'm in the makeup chair, it doesn't matter what. If I'm in an important business meeting, I will suck your balls in front of any company. I don't care. My mother or my grandmother's right there sitting on the couch in the room. I will suck your balls, sir. Just come on down anytime. Anytime you need your balls sucked, I will do it. Jimmy Fallon.
If you want to stand up and... If you want to stand up and drop trowel and jump up on my desk and just plop him in my mouth at any point during the interview, sir, you just do whatever feels right to you, sir. My mouth is just a hole for washing your balls, sir. Just think of it that way, okay? All right.
Mm-hmm. Trump, it's just like every day is a new thing. He gives a lot of material. A lot of stuff is hard to even make a joke about because it's just too serious.
Hello, Today fans. Thanks for checking.
Wow, what a nothing, middle of the road, fence humping statement from this empty, vacant fucking dude who somehow jumped his way into success somehow. Wow.
So this guy's got a team of writers, but he can't think of a Trump joke.
He can't come up with a single fucking thing of merit to say about anything, really.
Trump, he's got weird hair.
Well, I would say this probably has been the closest category for me, but I'm still going to give it to Jimmy, mostly for that cringy-ass ride, because I can't believe there's actually a ride that lame.
That ride is 100% cringe.
Give Jimmy another point.
So Jimmy officially
Fallon is the fucking whipping
Jimmy Fallon has officially won this cringe-off. With Matthew Broderick has not received a single vote yet, which I'm surprised. I told you, dude,
at the top of this fucking episode, did I not fucking tell you, TJ?
Let's take a look at their crowning achievements, gentlemen. Crowning achievements. Right. Okay. So Matthew Broderick, his two crowning achievements are probably the fact that he was Simba in The Lion King and that he was Ferris Bueller. I think that's pretty fair to say. His two biggest hit movies, two most iconic roles.
And both pretty cool, dude. Like, both pretty cool achievements to have on your life's work list. You know what I mean?
Yeah, not too keen on his portrayal of Simba, I guess, but whatever. It's like
what?
A cartoon lion, Nick. Simba was such a fucking straight man character, like you said.
Don't you understand that those characters are needed in stories? They may not be the most fucking... That's why I can appreciate Broderick, because he's not the dude you're ever going to fucking cast to play the breakout crazy fucking character. You'd never put Broderick as the Riddler. Right. Yeah. He's the stories need straight men, especially fucking.
He might be funny as the Riddler. He's like he'd be like the Riddler's accountant.
Right. Exactly. Like some dork.
But so like, those are I think those crowning achievements are pretty respectable, though. I mean, so whatever. So, of course, Jimmy Fallon. I mean, he is the host of The Tonight Show. Can't take it away.
You can't take it away from him. I mean, The Tonight Show. Say what you want about The Tonight Show being a pale imitation and shadow of its former self. I mean, all you want.
It certainly is.
That's all just salt. it's still the Tonight Show. It's still the same lineage that goes through Jay Leno right to Johnny Carson. So
how are his ratings on the Tonight Show?
I think,
I'm sure that they're
aren't all late night ratings suffering?
Maybe it's kind of fucking
ratings. Tonight Show ranks among number one in the week's late night broadcasts. So yeah, I mean, I guess for whatever the late night show circuit is at this point, he is the top of it.
Wow. So, that's depressing.
So like, you know, he beats all the others.
Well, whatever, I mean, probably just based on the name The Tonight Show. I mean, that's the right show. That's that name still carries weight with a lot of old people. They probably don't even try other shows. You know what I mean?
Its ratings have been in steady decline over the years. NBC is trying and, you know, flailing to try to get those ratings back up. But, of course, you know, the medium itself is not doing too great.
No,
general.
I mean, COVID kind of killed this type of show.
And having someone like Jimmy Fallon at the head of the show is not doing any favors either, because he's no Johnny Carson. He's not even a Jay Leno, and I don't even like Jay Leno.
No, I will say this about Jay Leno. He was a competent host of The Tonight Show for his tenure there, for most of it.
I mean, I don't really care for Jay Leno much, but I would say that, you know, I can at least point to some things where I'm like, he's talented in this respect. No, he had this kind of ability.
He made some edgy political fucking jokes, too. Like, that's another part of the lineage of The Tonight Show that Jimmy Fallon has just kind of decided to throw by the wayside in favor of his brand of Tonight Show. Like, Johnny Carson wasn't a big political guy, but he would often say it through his guests. And then Leno was a big political wonk when it came to his comedy and shit. Leno always had like a monologue for the president or the governor or whatever the fuck. So,
I mean, like, just look at this shit.
Yeah, oh yeah. I was gonna mention, like, yeah, Conan had a fucking brief little stint there.
Oh, yeah, brief little stint on
very the... brief little stint.
Jack Parr. But, yeah, I don't. Who's the Steve? Steve.
I don't know. He wasn't. I mean, Jack Parr and Johnny Carson were definitely the fucking big names there.
Right. Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
Jay Leno, of course. I mean, Jay Leno was a big name, whether I like him or not. I mean, Conan's tenure was whatever. He didn't even have enough time to actually do anything with the show.
Yeah.
I don't know who Steve was, but I mean, like, you know, you just look at this lineage and you're like, yeah. And oh, shit. Well, that fucking went off a cliff.
I mean, really off a cliff. Conan, I don't know how you feel about Conan. I think he's a pretty talented guy. He's a pretty funny guy.
You know what I really love about Conan? He has a quality that Johnny Carson had as well, honestly, where he can bomb a joke, but then turn the bombing of the joke into something funnier than the joke would have been if it landed.
Yeah, that's a rare skill to have. And it's so good to have that in the fucking
because, you know, this show is written so fucking quick. These writers are like constantly trying to fucking put jokes out there. And so a lot of them are just like, whatever. And so the ability to fucking get a laugh out of a bad joke, so much more, you know, such an important trait for these guys to have. Jimmy Fallon couldn't even get a fucking laugh out of a good joke most nights. So
well, he doesn't get any. But yeah, if somebody did accidentally write a good joke for Jimmy Fallon on his show, he wouldn't get a laugh.
There had to have been good jokes that were just like cranked out of that writing room, right? Like, there had to have occasionally been a fucking good joke to come out of there.
Find me one and I'll tell you.
Yes.
I mean, even if there was, though, Jimmy Fallon was the one that delivered it. So, like, what are you really going to do, you know?
Yeah, true that.
I mean, even if it was good, it's not going to be good then.
No, it won't be.
So, once again, you know, I mean, whatever. It's just like one-sided shit. I mean, so you should give it to the person with the least crowning achievement. I mean, like, I guess there's kind of a debate to be had here. Is being on The Tonight Show, even as the worst host, more of a crowning achievement than being Sitting on the Lion King and Ferris Bueller?
To answer your question.
I mean, The Tonight Show is a bigger cultural fucking thing, I think, than either of those things are.
It is. Well, all right. Well, it depends. Like, Ferris Bueller is a classic movie.
Sure.
And
so is The Lion King.
And so is The Lion King, right? And movies themselves are way bigger than The Tonight Show. The Tonight Show is like a remora on the underbelly of the fucking movie industry.
But in the TV industry, it's huge, or at least it has a huge tradition.
Right, it's the pinnacle of the TV industry, but this dude was Simba in The Lion King.
Yeah, but Jimmy Fallon is at the, like, Matthew Broderick ain't, like, at the tippy top of the fucking industry.
No, he ain't, but he was Simba in The Lion King, and he played Ferris Bueller, and Jimmy ruined The Tonight Show. That's what he's got under his belt. Like, look at this picture. He's the cringiest, worst host that The Tonight Show has ever had.
Yeah,
that
you can't turn it.
Like, yeah, it's a brag.
Crop Jimmy out.
Yeah, I don't know, dude. I can't. I mean, all right, you know what? Like, let's help Jimmy out. Let's go ahead and give him a fucking point, because I'm telling you, like, I'm not going to do it again, but I will vote for I'll vote for Matthew Broderick.
Let's just be honest here. I don't want to fucking give him a point just because if Jimmy Fallon deserves the point.
He deserves the point. That ride deserves the point. The fact that he wiped his ass with this roster of people's fucking work deserves the point.
When it comes to crowning achievements, like, here's the ultimate thing I think kind of decides it for me. Matthew Broderick's crowning achievements, like, he doesn't ruin those things. Like, in The Lion King, is he my favorite character in the movie? No, he's not, but whatever. He's the main character. He's kind of bland just by nature of his being. So he's kind of supposed to be that, because the other characters around him are the colorful characters. So he's fine in that role. And Ferris Bueller, I mean, he's good. He did a good job. He made the fucking movie work.
Right.
He didn't fuck up either of those things. Jimmy Fallon, he fucked up the thing that he was given. Like, he was given something big, and he's just like, he sucks. So I guess I got to give him the point on this as well. I don't know.
Well, shit.
Scotty, what do you think, Scotty?
Scotty, can I talk to you before you give your thoughts? Can I have a man-to-man with you?
Sure, man.
Just for the memes, let's vote fucking Broderick on this one, because I won't do it again, and I know you won't, and you know he ain't going to pull out another fucking 2 points. And let's keep it interesting, because, like, we end it now, then there's no chance of fucking Broderick winning. Then we
there's
have to
already
sit
no
and...
chance.
Wait, already is it already Fallon over?
It's already clinched.
It's already over.
No, I thought it was 3-3, and then if whoever wins this one, like...
No.
Or no, I thought he had to win every one after this.
Fallon won Early Life, Fallon won TV, Fallon won Film, and then Fallon won Other Cringe.
Shit!
So it's now we're crowning achievements.
Well,
over.
Then fuck it.
All right. Vote.
Give it a Fallon.
Nine vote for Broderick. It's Fallon.
Yeah. I didn't realize we were already past the point of no return. I thought we were
past that, dude.
I'm a little stoned. There you go, then. Never mind. Right. I retract.
TJ. You are a fucking deplorable piece of fucking shit, dude. That is
bonus round.
Bonus round. Yeah. Fuck you, TJ. I'm going to talk over your fucking clip because you're a pile of shit. Yeah, you're a fucking pile of worthless fucking garbage.
Scotty, I'm not done torturing you yet.
Watching this shit.
I'm not done torturing you, Scotty. See them together. Dude, let's see how they interact.
It's over. It's over, TJ.
Watch them interact, Scotty.
It's over, TJ. Dude, this is fucking goddamn torture now, TJ. You already know the outcome. The game is fucking signed, sealed, and delivered.
We still got to do the bonus
round,
Scotty.
Jimmy Fallon won. Okay, yeah, fuck you, man. You're a fucking horrible human being.
Even if the score at the end of the third quarter is like 100-0, you still got to play that fourth quarter, Scotty. You still got to play it.
Yeah, you're the king of cringe, TJ.
I mean, like, before they show it, you get to see it. Yeah. And it's great. It's really clever. Good one.
That was a great one. Yeah, it was super fun to see her as Carrie. I thought it was super fun.
Yeah, she's Carrie again and Jeff Bridges.
I saw a photo of you and a friend that went viral pretty recently. Do you know about this photo that I'm taking?
I think so. Yeah, I took a picture with a friend of mine.
Jimmy's so creepy.
We were walking.
Dude, you know what? This really cements it, though. I'll give you that. This does cement, like, they're both sitting there, they're both talking, and it's like, who is, like, more awkward and less likable? And it's Jimmy Fallon. It really is.
It is, but they're both doing a fucking number on me, dude. They're both so...
They're neck and neck.
Dry and just so uninteresting.
Maybe they get in more interesting halfway through.
It's a story. It's a rabbi who, his wife dies.
They don't.
It sounds very grim, but
it's a rabbi. His wife could die,
and he's very upset about it and miserable about it. And
want to bet this story is going to conclude in a fake laugh from Jimmy Fallon?
See
if he does this big fake laugh.
It looks like he missed it. Maybe there. I don't know.
No, I don't think he does it.
Go back to the earth.
Yeah,
you know he's very worried because there's things about her body returning to nature.
Oh my God.
I just swooned.
Oh, go back.
Fantastic.
Go back.
There we go.
It's the first.
I need a.
Cat in the clip.
Here's where we get the fake laugh.
I just swooned.
He did. Oh, fantastic.
Wow.
So first,
I need a...
You just... Wow. Damn, dude. You know what, Paul? You know what, TJ? Maybe Jimmy Fallon kind of knows this competition's going on. I think he kind of knows a little bit. He's like, I'm going to fucking eye fuck Broderick.
Matthew Broderick and Jimmy get lost in each other's eyes mid-interview. So apparently that happened, and that's why they're laughing, because they're gay.
Dude, I think Broderick's uncomfortable with being, you know, gay. He's uncomfortable with it, man.
He's in denial. Here's another one. Because why only have them once?
Is that Nathan Lane?
Yeah, it is.
I'm getting a call.
Hold on. Nathan Lane might actually be funny.
It's the closet calling. It wants you to come out, Nathan.
Oh my God, you guys are so awesome.
Yeah, why is he like that? Like, just come out already.
And so Nathan Lane heeded TJ's wisdom and got married.
This might accidentally be funny, though, because Nathan Lane's here.
So. Well, yeah, that's true.
I forgot who I was.
Yeah, well, that's because Nathan Lane's an actual funny guy, and he made you laugh really hard.
Let's start fighting, all right? Let's start
fighting.
I told you, man.
All three of these guys fucked after the show, just letting you guys know.
100%.
Nathan was on top.
Yeah, Nathan dommed the whole fucking event, dude.
Matthew was in the middle, and Jimmy Fallon was on the bottom.
Yeah,
the bottom,
Jimmy sure. Fallon was put in the cock cage. And he got no satisfaction from the event. He was not allowed an orgasm.
Now, Master Broderick.
Broderick was domed, but got to come. And of course, Nathan came countless times.
So over and over again.
As many times as he pleased.
So, yeah. The bonus. Who wins the bonus round?
I don't know. Nobody. We lose.
I guess no points awarded anywhere. It's just a tie in that round. Just whatever. We're just calling that one a wash. But Fallon cleans up. So let me just show you guys.
A landslide episode, dude. Not even close.
I mean, the scoreboard is almost pointless to show, but I'll go
TJ,
ahead.
TJ, did you go into this knowing it was going to be all Fallon? Did you credibly think it was going to be close?
I thought that Matthew Broderick's blandness would be able to fucking withstand Fallon's cringe, but
wrong.
I was totally wrong. Unpleasantly, actually.
It was a route, dude.
You heard me, Scotty, before we started even recording this show. What did I say in the pre-show? I said this was going to be a runaway train for Jimmy Fallon. Jimmy Fallon's one of the cringiest entities that ever existed in the history of cringe. And Broderick is a little cringy, but he's not cringy enough, dude.
I honestly regret even giving Paul shit for it. I'm like, oh, no. But, yeah, seeing the evidence, it's not even been close. Everything we've seen has just been so clear-cut. Broderick's lame. He's boring. He's bland. You know, whatever. He sucks. But it's like the sucky dude who's just there, like... Instead of a scenery chewing character, he's like the fucking plant, you know? He's like the
plant in the corner.
He's like the plant in the corner. Like, you know what? For Hollywood, he's a rare thing. He's this ultra safe, ultra fucking reliable. I'm sure even behind the scenes, just kind of the bland, boring dude that's like, okay, I'll be what this role. He's that. He's super safe. And Jimmy Fallon's just super fucking bad. He's super cringe.
He's Jimmy fucking Fallon, dude. He's horrible.
He's creepy. He's overbearing. He's awkward. He's just fucking. He's so fake and full of shit. He's a fucking disgrace. Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, there you go. Thank you, Jimmy. I appreciate that, Jimmy. Thank you for that fake laugh. Like the little monkey banging the fucking goddamn cymbals together.
Oh, it's funny.
Ugh.
All right, go ahead and tell a joke, TJ. Tell a joke, TJ.
Why did the chicken cross the road, Scotty?
I don't know.
To get to the other side, Scotty.
That's fucking funny, TJ. That's fucking funny. Stop laughing, TJ. Stop fucking laughing. It's not funny. Not fucking funny, Jimmy. Not funny.
Jimmy Fallon wins. That's our show. The cringiest has
knockout,
been reviewed.
Dude. It is a fucking knockout.
That was a one round. That was like Tyson versus Stick
Who gives
Finger.
A fuck?
I don't know how to fucking call it.
Yeah, one of those poor people that got knocked out in the first round against Tyson. One of those guys whose names will never be remembered.
That's like the fucking 15-second KO. It's like walk up, knock him out, done.
Thanks for watching, y'all. Bye bye.
Deep fat fried. Deep fat fried. Deep fat fried. Deep fat fried.